A very happy morning to everyone. Thank you for joining us for today's webinar. It gives me an immense pleasure to welcome our chief guest, Mr. Arun Kumar Kanthi, Manager, Accenture Solutions India Limited, Bangalore, founding former Cordu Organics. Respected HOD sir, faculty members, and my dear students, for today's webinar on Smart Idea to Business. Now, I request our respected HOD sir to introduce the chief guest on this session. Please, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Good morning to everyone. I welcome you all for Institutions Innovations Council webinar on Smart Idea to Business, organized by the Department of Electronics and Instrumentation Engineering of RMD Engineering College. I extend my warm welcome to the speaker of today's session, Mr. Arun Kumar Kanthi, Manager, Accenture Solutions India Private Limited, Bangalore, founding former Cordu Organics. It is a great pleasure to introduce the speaker of today's session, Mr. Arun Kumar Kanthi. He completed BTech Chemical Engineering from Coimbatore Institute of Technology in the year 2003, MBA Finance System from Bharathidasan Institute of Management, Tiruchirappalli in the year 2007. He worked as a regional research laboratory project engineer in CSIR organization Trivandrum for 2 years, operation and regional credit manager in ICICI Bank Limited for 2 years and 11 months, as a senior consultant in Infosys for 5 years and 11 months, deputy vice president, business solutions delivery, Equitas Small Finance Bank in Chennai area for 1 year and 4 months, as a senior consultant in Accenture Bangalore from July 2017 to till date. He is a seasoned professional with 15 years of industry experience, primarily in banking and financial service domain, with specialized skills in product management, requirements gathering, gap analysis, complex solution consulting, change management, customer training, business process definition, and branch operation. He also involved in multiple core banking implementations in the Asia Pacific, Western, and South African markets. Some achievements of our speaker: he won Best Consultant Award from Infosys Limited, won GEM Award for implementation of core banking in an Indian bank, authored a blog and paper in microfinancing and mobile banking. He received awards as a best credit manager in retail financing in the organization of ICICI Bank, the youngest RCM in the division mentor for the new recruits into the team and training them on the features of the product and policy. Mr. Arun Kumar Kanthi is also a founding farmer of Cordu Organics. A brief information about Cordu Organics Farm. It is a farm formed by a group of young farmers who believe in our traditional farming and started producing our natural, own natural and organic food. Since there is a gap in authenticity, availability and affordability of the organic food staples, they joined hands with a network of farmers, helped and guided them starting from sourcing seeds till the end of the produce cycles with their pesticide-free food staples from our certified network of farmers to the retailers. So we are very proud to have Mr. Arun Kumar Kanthi for today's session. On behalf of Electronics and Instrumentation Department and my own behalf, I welcome our speaker of today's session, Mr. Arun Kumar Kanthi. Sir, you are welcome, sir. Now I invite Mr. Arun Kumar Kanthi to take over the session. Please, sir.
மிக்க நன்றி. தேங்க் யூ. அனைவருக்கும் என் காலை வணக்கம். இட்ஸ் பீன் ரியல் பிளஷர் டு ஜாயின் த செஷன் டு இன்டராக்ட் வித் தி யங் மைண்ட்ஸ். ஐ தேங்க் தி மேனேஜ்மெண்ட், HOD அண்ட் ஸ்டாஃப் மெம்பர்ஸ் அலாங் வித் ஸ்டூடெண்ட்ஸ் ஃபார் கிவிங் மீ திஸ் ஆப்பர்ச்சுனிட்டி டு ஷேர் மை ஐடியாஸ் அண்ட் இன்டராக்ட் வித் ஹவு வி ஹவ் டிரான்ஸ்ஃபார்ம்ட் அவர் டிரான்ஸ்ஃபார்மேஷன் ஜேர்னி வித் யூ ஆல். தேங்க் யூ. I'll start from a journey, a vision, rather a passion of eating good food. Basically, it started in after a few years of completing my corporate journey with many organizations. I found that there is one thing that is pushing me is what I'll do next after getting a promotion, after getting a salary revision, what is next for me. And when I visualized my career for next 15, 20 years, I felt that there was an emptiness, that I'll be in the ladder of organization, but what is the contribution that I'm doing to the society? And that is always a hitch that when I started, when people asked me when I was in a grade of 12th standard, or when I doing my engineering, or even during my MBA days, when people asked me what you wanted to do, I always used to say that I want to do bit to the society which I belong, and I want to contribute something to the agriculture industry. I call it as an industry with reasons. The agriculture is a big industry. Then after a few years of the corporate journey, I felt that there is an emptiness. What I'll do next? Then I visualized, okay, why can't I have a good food, basically? Then in the journey of getting into good food, I visited me. I was looking for many opportunities. What I'll do next? Then when I visited my father-in-law's farm, he was using lots of fertilizers, and the input cost to the fertilizers are huge, which a farmer cannot afford in his in the growing cycle, actually. So when there was a small piece of land which he cultivated for himself and his family, when I asked, he said it is for him. What is that? It means there is no fertilizers added, no chemical fertilizers added to it, and it is for their family. That is where the this is a and when inquired more about them, they told he told me that this is how our ancestors used to do. Then I was exploring what our ancestors were doing. Then I found many of the document pieces, the knowledge piece was missed or not transpired to the next generation of people. So that is where the spark came. Okay, let me start something which has meaningful journey. So that is where the CADU started. What is the meaning of CADU? Is in forest we won't do any application of fertilizers. No insecticides are sprayed. No pesticides are sprayed. The growth journey is automatic. The plants, the insects, everything see to them on its own. And the growth happens, and it yields, and it tastes a lot better than what we produce, basically. So I wanted to reach a state where all the produce grown in my farm is grown automatically without any user inputs, basically. Though it's a distant dream, yeah, I'm on towards that, actually. So in 2016, we have started the CADU Organics on a mission to give good food staples for at least 1% of the Indian food consumption market. 1% is very, very huge. People say, Arun, you are too greedy. 1% of total Indian population, just think about that. Everybody is basically, for Indian food consumption is nothing but our total population, 120 billion population. 1% of that is too huge. And I'm aiming for that. Yes, I'm too greedy, that I want my people to eat good food, basically. So when this is a short story on how we ventured into CADU Organics, and I'll transfer you to what happened in last 4 years of our journey. There were lots of challenges. We were new to farming, meaning we are all were though our ancestors from farming background, we are new actually, and the method that we are going to adapt, our ancestral technologies. And there is no proof or document that are available in the market, actually. So water management, we are very new to. Since we are very new, we followed what these people were using. That is the channel irrigation. Lots of waters are wasted during the transportation of water. So we were looking into it, actually. What is crop rotation? Crop rotation, what we can do if I cultivate a rice or a paddy this season, next season we can't do. We were not aware of that. Pest management is a big challenge when we go for organic farming. And input management, it is without any fertilizers. Then we need to search for what is good, what is the biofertilizers, what is the natural fertilizer that we can make. And labor management is always a challenge. Even now it is a challenge. And the beauty is
we are operating from a distance of close to 700 kilometers from the farm. My farm is situated in down south, close to Kanyakumari district, and I am based out of Bangalore. So it is close to 700 kilometers distance. So these were the challenges that is in front of us, and we were completely relying on the technology, what will help us to achieve our vision of producing a sustainable food without any chemicals. So it is of world of internet. What I meant here in world of internet is we read lots of, we gather lots of information from the internet, various apps specifically designed for agricultural, organic agricultural stuff. And we started giving it a trial. We bought the land in 2016, and our first cultivation, I would say, it started in September 23rd, 2017. In 1.5 years' time, we took that much time to ensure that there is a proper infrastructure available to meet our needs. That is infrastructure. What I refer here is that irrigation facility, irrigation, input management, labor management. These are all being taken care in by some means. I have not followed the channel irrigation. We have gone with the drip irrigation. Though Israel has gone before 25 to 30 years before they are ahead of us, they have started the drip irrigation. We have started in 2016. We have started using the drip irrigation, though it was much prevalent there at that time. But it was not well received by the farmers at that. Even now, it was not well received. Though people talk about drip irrigation, we use drip irrigation, and there was an electricity connection. It was not. It was a barren land that we have got. It was a barren land. I repeat, it was a barren land. I'll show you an image of the barren land that we have got. This is how the land was when we bought the land parcel. This is how it was before in 2016. And now, so we have understood the irrigation methods. We have gone with the drip irrigation. Gradually, we have moved on with drip along with the rain hose facilities, along with the sprinkler. We have gone one by one. And crop rotation is one thing. Again, technology is one thing which helped us. And the knowledge that we have gathered in our engineering days and the MBA days. We have taken the study of the local market. Though there was a huge demand in the market outside of my place in Bangalore and Chennai, I went to the local market and understand what is good, and what can be, you know, cultivated in my farm. After giving a thorough study, we have started with the trial and error method of cultivating 700 banana saplings in one small piece. Though I have a large area, I can grow up to 20,000 banana trees in my farm. I started with 700 trees. Then I started documenting each and every piece in my Facebook page, which is available for any novice who wanted to get into farming. I documented each and every piece with the 4 months knowledge that we have gathered. Then I expanded to again 1,200 banana saplings. Then another 1 year of time, we have cultivated, we started planting again another 1,800 banana. So at one time, after a year's time, we have close to 3,000 to 3,500 banana saplings growing at my farm. That is where we have started. And the pest controls, we have used the technology. Technology was helping us a lot. Solar traps were used. Sticky pads were used. With the color combination, there is a stick which attached, which attracts the pest. And pest, the male or the female gets stuck onto the sticky pad. And it lays eggs there. It cannot, you know, fertigate, actually. So after a year of study, from 2017, we have started cultivating, and 2018, I felt, though we say that I am doing agriculture, I'm doing farming, I was not really contributing to the farm. So that is where, when we were dependent on the labors to operate, to irrigate the land. So we approached a wireless-based automation company, which works on IoT, Internet of Things. we are the first farm in my belt who has installed the automated valves. They call it a solenoid valves, which is operated through mobile phone. Actually, yeah, there is a SIM inserted in the system in the process in the controller. I'll show that image also. Probably that might interest you guys, you being the instrumentation guys. This is the setup that we have. This is the processor which control. This is the controller which controls the valves. And here is where we insert the SIM card and the solenoid valves. This is the solenoid valves that I'm talking about. This is the solenoid valves that I'm talking about, which operates on the internet in the mobile. So then after installing all, now since 2018 August, I fertigate my land, I irrigate my land using mobile processor, mobile application. I select the number of walls which I need to fertigate. I select the time. I'll show the simple images of how the app looks like. I select, I'll say for walls 1 and 2, I need to irrigate for 2 hours. I set the time there. And automatically when the time is up, the valve, the pump, the motor switches off. It is, if there is no water in that, again, it gives an alert message to me that there is no water. If the current is switched off, it gives an alert that there is no power in your farm. So I started using that. It was, when we use the technology, there was always a reluctance. When I spend close to a lakh for installing, six solenoid valves, my father-in-law, who is a traditional farmer, who was very much against that, using the technology. Why we need that? Can we do that? Can be done with the labor? Why you want to install with so much money? We can invest that in some other opportunity, or we can have a new crop. Then I said, no, I don't want to rely on the labor. I wanted to be independent from the labor. At least I'm feeling happy. The satisfaction of irrigating my land gives lots of satisfaction. So I wanted to do that. He said, it's up to you. You guys don't know the value of money, and you don't know, it will not work as you visualize. Then after a year of operation in 2019, when I was not here due to the 2019 end and all, if you see, my father-in-law, he himself says, can you switch on the motor, because the labor is not available today. Can you see to that it is working correctly? That is a change, no? We have got it. Then he was inquiring, can we do this in our farm? What needs to be done? But since he was not tech savvy, he don't want to use the app, basically. Then I told, you can use even with messages, you can do that. So we are with the initial intention of not, it cannot be used anywhere, it cannot work, it cannot serve the purpose. Now he recommends people that you can, why can't you use automated valves? That is one step. Then when the bananas are taken to the market, local market, okay, prices are fixed by the local commission agents, basically, which I'm a bit against of it. So I want to make a value addition project, value added products to it. Value added, what I can do with the bananas and the vegetables. When while exploring, we have got an option of using a solar dryer, because the heat in our area, Tirunal Valley is known for that, basically. So we have installed a solar dryer with a minimal capacity of 410 square feet. With the sensors, we can control the temperature inside it. And we started producing a value-added product. I'll show the image of the value-added product. And this is the dryer that I'm talking about. This is a solar dryer. And the value-added product is one thing. I don't have an image now. From the red bananas, we have started drying the bananas, and we have started giving the value-added product, basically. The shelf life of the product is close to 11 months. I have lab tested that. If I need to sell that in the local market, it might be 10 to 15 rupees per kg. But when I sell it by value adding the product, it gives at least, you know, 4 to 5 times of the four to five times of the market price if I sold it immediately. And the shelf life is tremendous. It is commendable. It is close to 11 months. Okay, so that is the difference. When I install, people say, why you need a solar dryer? Again, as usual, not accepting. When we introduce a technology, there is always a reluctance. There is all, when we introduce a change, there is always a word of caution, word of criticism is always there. But in my area, after we installed the solar dryer, there were close to 6 people, farmers, who have installed the solar dryers. We operated, we have gradually moved on to the solar pumps. Instead of getting another electricity connection, I have surrendered my electricity connection and free connection, and I have started using the solar pump. And initial thoughts of, again, solar pump won't work. Even after 500 feet, it will not work. All this has been trashed. And many people from local area started visiting my farm to check whether the solar dryer is solar pump is working efficiently in Kado Organics farm. So we were very successful in introducing new technologies to the people from my area. And all this were, I started, since I got into the certification, world of certification, that organic certification, we need to have a monitoring system there. And I've installed the CCTV cameras in my farm at around 10 places to see who is coming in, whether anybody is bringing in anything which is not allowed into an organic farm. All these were taken care through CCTV stuff. And this is how we started using the technology or relying on the technology. The walls is a big hit. Solar dryer is one thing that I always cherish. Solar pump through sensors and through CCTVs. These are the different technologies we have adopted in the in our farming journey, and the technology has really, really helped us in taking our farm to the next level. How are we different, basically? We mostly sell direct to customers, basically. From our farm, we sell to customers. Then, based on the demands, we started, sourcing from our reliable farmers. See, last 2 months, I'm on a visiting many organic farmers who are very, very passionate about giving good food. I wanted to join with them in my vision, in organic vision, Kado Organics vision of, serving at least 1% of the Indian food population. So we visit them, we see them, how they use it, and we introduce these technologies. You can use this, you can use that to automate your farming journey to effectively work from the distance. I operate my farm from somewhere to kilometers. In a click of a few touches, the irrigation starts in my area. So on a visiting spree, we introduce the technologies to the farmers, and all these products, we started sourcing produce from the farmers. We encourage them to make value-added products. If I say black rice or millets, people next question they ask is how to use it. So we have started giving value-added products like laddus from black rice or laddus from millets. The dried bananas, I started giving it in honey. My kids used to have the solar dried honey soaked banana as an alternate snack. After we all say that, many people started, organic is a big business. So many people say, I'm into organics. I do all this. I do this and all. So what happened is we wanted to really, really tell our people that what we say is what we practice, basically. So we started testing our samples, like the jaggery powder sourced, or the oil that we are sourcing, or the rices that we source, if it is more than a ton. We started giving it for the samples, and it is pesticide free tested. For example, if you ask me, cane jaggery powder, it is tested for 2-4-6 pesticides that can be found in a jaggery powder, and it is free from that. So we started giving the residual free product, and we started giving a good value for the farmers. The prices are fixed throughout the year. It is since 2019 till date, the prices are fixed for my produce. I sell bananas, red bananas, or Indian bananas, or banana, Ilaki bananas, or the vegetables at one fixed price. There is not much of change or fluctuation in the price. So I always quote an example: the small onion, which was selling at 250 rupees per kg, we were selling it at 70 rupees per kg even at that time. Even if it was selling at 40 rupees or 30 rupees, we used to sell that small onion at a rate of 70 rupees. This is for information. Probably it may not attract any interest for you, but this is an example that I want to quote you. So after doing all this, what all can be done? Have I used all the technologies in my farm? Are there any scope for improvement? Are there any opportunities where the technology can play a role in my farm? Yes, there is an opportunity. So this might really interest you guys to tickle your thinking tank. What as an instrumentation engineer, what all you can contribute to the farming society, the farmers. Probably many might be from the farming background. You might have seen your father, your uncles might have been into farming and struggling with various issues actually. So I'll go one by one, and this piece basically is very important for you guys basically. You can have all ears to it. See, for a farm, spraying is done manually with the help of manual labor. We have a sprayer. Yes, there is a machine. We have a sprayer. It is solar operated. We use a solar operated solar sprayer. But we depended on labor basically. If I wanted to spray my field with fertilizers, whether it is organic, inorganic, or naturally grown fertilizer, naturally produced fertilizer. If I want to spray that, I'm independent of labor, or I need to get into the field actually, and I'm not available at the farm. So drone is available. That is how the drone, probably you all may be knowing what I'm talking about. Drone is there. It's sprayed with the capacity 15 liters, 8 liters, 2 liters, 3 liters with various sizes. It can spray the entire field of acre in less than 10 minutes. But if I do that with the labor, probably it might take me half day to at least 4 to 5 hours a day of a manual labor work to spray the entire farm of 1 acre. So drone is available there. Okay, it is available. But what we are looking is any technology should be used. It should be affordable basically. When I produce in food, it should be affordable for the people basically. So when we started giving organic produce, we were very clear our produce should be affordable for the farmers, affordable for the consumers basically. So the drone technology is already there, but can't we create an affordable drone? Say when I inquire to have a drone for me for Cardo Organics on its own, there were lots of procedures involved. Apart from the procedure, the investment that I need to make is close to 8 lakhs. For a fertilizer tank of 15 liters, 8 liters, sorry. So whether a small farmer, small and medium farmer can afford that, not possible. So please tinker your minds to ensure that to come up with a product of an affordable drone. If anything between less than 50 to 1 lakh, people will be definitely interested because the opportunity cost or the benefit that I'm deriving out from the drone is, from that product is enormous. And it serves the purpose of connecting the technology with the farmer. So that is one thing. That is one area that you can think. And sprayer without drone. Yeah, drone is there. But to operate a drone, there is lots of formalities involved. One is to get a flying license. The person who is flying, who is operating the drone, needs to have a flying license, which means I need to be there when I operate the drone. So this is not if I get a license on my name. Others cannot operate the drone. That is one thing, one challenge. Second one is it should be cleared from the local fire station or the police station to get the clearance. And there is a policy laid out by the Air Force Department on how we can operate the drone. So instead of that, is there any alternative? Yeah. There is an alternative that we can think through. This is what I have. I'm in discussion with few engineers who can help me out with the drones. Vertical and forward moving sprayers. instead of me holding that sprayer in my bag or flying it, operating flying, can I have a sprayer? It's nothing but a trolley which mounts the tank, and we can have an adjustable height to move the sprayers basically with the pump. So can we think something? Can I operate it sitting at one place? A camera fixed in front can visualize the routes, can get the guidance of the route, and it clears the route for me to travel, for the sprayer to travel and it sprays. If I need to spray to a vegetables plant, or if I need to spray for the papaya tree or for the coconut tree, can the height be adjusted vertically? And if I need to rotate in a circular motion, can that be done? So we are looking for if any investments or any think tank who can think and come up with the instruments in that manner, definitely that is going to be helpful for the farmers. Always keep in mind that we are trying to address the small and medium farmers who has less than 2.5 acres of land. Why small and medium farmers is the small and medium farmers contribute more than 80% of the total farming community in India. So that is where let's target the mass. If we target the mass, the price can be compromised, not the quality. So that is where I'm coming. So this is one thing. The next one is on the fertigation. I have an automated wall. Can I have a fertilizer tank? Again, this piece is available. This piece is available. It is in very, very initial stages. They talk about in lakhs again. If I say 1, 2, 3 fertilizers is stored in particular tank. Now I'm irrigating wall one. For this wall one, tank number fertilizer one needs to be applied. I select valves and the tank, and the tank number, it needs to automatically open. It need to go along with the irrigation irrigation source. So can we do something for this? It is there already. I'm telling it is there already. You don't need to think much, or you don't need to spend much of your time in how it will be. It is already there. How it will be? What we need to do to ensure that quality can be given with the less cost? See when US is sending a rocket of around they spend close to millions of dollars. We send a rocket in 710 crores, which is not even 1/10 of their total budget. So similar lines I'm talking. Can we do something with our own minds and raw materials? Can we come up with some instruments for the farmers? Again, that is a fertigation. That comes with the IoT concept. Anyway, that you knows better than me. Second is the next one is the disease identification. Yes, there is a mapping. If I click on if I click on an image of a banana tree, a banana leaf from a plant, it has a disease. I click the image. It needs to map with the database that I have. It says this is the issue. This is the cropping facilities. This is the measurement that you need to give. That you need to apply these fertilizers or apply to this chemical or the organic or the natural pesticides. You apply this basically. So again, this is there, but the challenge is the cost. It is not taken up to the grassroots level. So can we do something for this? Next one is the moisture monitoring. Moisture is very, 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 very critical for the plant's growth. Moisture depends, the growth of a plant depends on the moisture content in the around its area of a 1 feet or around 1 feet or 2 feet, depends on the plant or the tree that has been cultivated. So if there is a way to address this moisture monitoring, for example, what I'm talking is, if there is a less moisture in a particular field, a particular area of my farm, it should be given alert. There is an issue in the moisture, can you please address it? What is the address? Probably how I need to address, probably I need to irrigate that land by operating the walls. It needs to give me instructions basically. Can't we do something? And along with the moisture monitoring, there is one thing that I'm talking about, one thing we can integrate is the weather mapping. How the weather forecast, I would say. The weather forecast, if it is going to be rain, whether I need to moisture it now, for irrigated now. No, can we integrate these two and say in this area, no, it's gonna rain now. Don't irrigate now, or don't give a recommendation. Don't sow any seeds now, or don't plow. All these no recommendations basically can be given. And similar to that, pest repellents. I'm talking pest repellents. In coconut fields and all, no, we have lots of, not only in coconut field, I'm giving an example, in coconut fields there are lots of challenges due to pest. Can we do something when insects of particular color, particular size, shape, with particular sound is approaching or getting into my farm, tree or my in that area, can we do something to analyze and give an indication, something like that, to the owner of the land? Say, we have sensed this image, this insects in your farm, please take necessary action. Something like that, no? Accordingly, if it is all interconnected, a pest is identified, I get an alert, then I fertigate it through my sprayer to ensure that it is not coming. If I need to spray, then I need to check whether it's suitable now to spray or not. It is all a package I'm talking about. It is not. It can be given as a individual components. If you see a whole holistic picture, it's all integrated. I cannot spray a fertilizer or a pesticide. Pesticide refer here as the, for us it's always a natural grown or organic pesticides. Since we will not kill any pesticide as that of the chemical does. If I need to spray a fertilizer or a pesticide, whether the climate is suitable, whether it's supporting that or not. If I spraying that now, and if it rains immediately, it's of no use basically. So I'm talking about a whole package which can be given to the farmers. So these are very small challenges, 50 challenges that we have talked about, that we have faced in our farm. Whether these can be addressed, whether these can be addressed is what, we are working with the engineers from various people, various fields. And we are looking for support from young minds. If you can come, young minds have lots of thought process, lots of ideas, and that is a very essential. I'm talking much about. I'm spending more time in each of these items. Okay, so I've told you about the valves and its functionality. This is how a valve is. Say currently the valve is in operation. It is off. It is an off stage. If I select here, if I click here, it will take me to the next page, wherein I can select the number of valves. And see, this is a sample report. Hope you all can see my screen now, right? Kathika, can you confirm?
Yes, sir. Yes, yeah. Sir. It is visible, sir.
So see, this is I have operated. Today 28th is today, right? Yeah. Since morning, I have operated valve 1 and 3 for close to 1 hour 35 minutes. Yesterday, you can see the track of how many hours we have tracked. Since yesterday, I have operated for less time. I have myself sitting on my farm, sitting on my play house itself, I have operated the motor. Now it is running. When I selected the image, screenshot, until that point, it is this much. So this is the image I'm talking about. So I want you to look at the journey. This is how the different journeys are. It was a barren land. We have cultivated. We have plowed. This is how it was earlier. All empty. We can't stand in that place basically. See the transformation. We have started planting. We have installed walls. This is the yield. This is the growth. We have different. This is solar pump I'm talking about. We have seen the solar trap. This is the solar trap that we have talked about. Solar pumps. This is rain hose basically. This is my. This is the sprinklers. You can see the images of the sprinklers here. This is the sprinklers. So this is my source from bore wells. We connect to your well. We created a sump. From through this we operate. So this is the machines that we use. And this is one of the paddy variety which grows more than 7 feet. So essentially, what is it? From a barren land, we have transformed our land to a fertile land. This journey has taken us close to 4 years. In this 4 years of journey, we have closely married to the technology, I would say. And then before 4 years, when I was doing this there were lots of reluctancy from the farmers, from the surroundings, from my well-wishers that it cannot work. Whatever you are trying to do will fail definitely. You know, please be cautious. Ensure that you take adequate, you know, measures to safeguard your back, basically. And with the technology help, I would say, so when I see my farm through my camera, or when I operate the field, when I on the switch on the valves, I feel really happy as if I'm doing the farming directly in the farm. So the technology has really helped. And what I'm insisting is technology can do much more than what I'm talking about. Whatever I've talked, it's a holistic package that to my capacity I've thought through. But as I was repeatedly telling you, young minds can think a lot better than, because there is no burden on them. Because I have lots of, as an individual, I need to answer many questions from my well-wishers and my surroundings. But for you, you are young buds. You can think differently. Out of the box ideas can come from you. It can be nothing. But from nothing only, there are from small drops we can create wonderful things, basically. So on a whole, this is the package. Probably this might interest you. This is the solenoid valve I'm talking about. It can be operated with the mobile app, basically. So hope you have seen this images. One minute. That is it from me, and you can now. I'm opening the floor for any questions, basically. I'm happy to answer, because I don't want to take much time in telling what I've done, what are we, who are we, how we transform. This is okay. But let's think, talk, discuss. It's about discussion, basically. I may not have answers for the questions that you ask, but it's a good platform to discuss through on the various options that we have, or the challenges, to address the challenges, basically. The floor is open now, guys. You can come up with questions. Kartika, it's on to you now. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your wonderful presentation. My question is, what is the process to get the organic farm certificate, sir?
Okay. You are a farmer by any chance, sir? No, sir. I'm curious. You are a farmer by any chance, sir?
No, sir.
Okay. Good. It's a good question, actually. So, there are a set of, it is very simple, and the Tamil Nadu Organic Certification Department is helping us a lot in getting the certification process easier. There are a set of documents that we need to give. The documents are very straightforward. It is Patta, Chitta, Adangal, water test report, soil test report, and the sale deed copy, the cropping plan for the next 1 year, annual plan for the next 1 year, and an information about your farm, basically. What does, where is your farm located? What is its surroundings? When we create a farm, when we certify it, there should be a buffer zone, because if your neighbor farm is using a fertilizer, there is a chances that when he sprays it, it may come into your farm. So we need to have a buffer zone around your farm, like planting three layers of trees. So in our farm, if you see, we have close to 1,600 savuku trees in our farm, and the next layer is surrounded by teak, Malay Vembu, Punnai, Punge, Shemmaram, Kumil. All these different trees are around my farm, around our farm, which gives a first level or second level protection to the fertilizers, which acts as a buffer zone sprayed from the farm. So all this information needs to be fed in there. So apart from your Aadhaar or PAN card, a photo, your land documents with the Adangal and FMB, your farm details, and your annual cropping plan with the DD of 3,500, you can send it to the TNOCD department, and they will arrange, they will check, they'll go through the entire details of what you have entered, and they'll do a visit to the farm. It is a 3 years process, basically. When you do a 1 year crop, perennial crop, when you do a 1 year crop, it's a 3 year process. And they will, once in a quarter, they visit the farm, and once in half year, they do a surprise visit to see whether they are using anything or not, any fertilizers or not. So we are following the rules of what is laid down by the organic department. Nothing, you need to, only thing is you need to use only the organic or the natural fertilizers that is allowed. And if you are using any other fertilizers as recommended by the department, you need to get prior notifications from prior approval from the department that there are certain set of pesticides and fertilizers, chemical pesticides and fertilizers that are allowed in the field, but you need to use it with proper approval and there is a dosage. You need to submit that, then you can use it basically. It is a 3-year process. We are in the third year. We are almost in the third year, actually, third year of our process. But since our land is a barren land, from day one, we can call that as an organic land. But we are looking at the organic content in the land, actually, organic carbon content, we call, to see whether the organic carbon content is really improved or not. And it has, we can see the difference in the soil, basically. When I dig a pit for last month, when I dig a pit to plant a sapling, avocado sapling to be precise, in one feet, I can see earthworms, you know, coming out from that, actually. So, which means that our soil is not changing, basically, and it is getting fertile. So it's a 3-year process. You need to fill the with all the docs, you need to fill the details, and you need to share it with the department. And this is the answer for you. And what happened is, since the education that we had, what I did is, whatever he has asked me to do, I did that. I prepared a package, and with that, you know, I have completed the my form details. I have got the opinion from him. I've asked him to have a look at it. He said it is all fine. You need to change here and there. Whatever the changes that he has recommended, we have updated that. After that, I have a set of, you know, entire set of documents which I have submitted to the form to the department. So that is now easy for the people. They share it across. This is how you need to do it. So when farmers approaches, I have tied up with many farmers, many natural farmers. I used to share that only one document to them. Just go through this. It contains everything that you wanted to do. If there is any doubt, please let me know. I can help you out. With one document, they can see the entire process of, you know, getting the organic certification. So the certification process, instead of not, we have got the certification as we grow, as using the technology and using the, you know, the education that we have had, we are helping the farmers also to get the certification so that they'll get a better price in the market for them.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
There is one piece, sorry, I would like to add, there is a one piece, you know, on the marketability and the crop rotation. I've started up, but I, you know, moved on to the next one. I've talked about the crop rotation, the market best suitable for the season, the marketability. This piece I've talked about, but I've not explained in detail. We have waited for 1 year. We have collected, when we sell the produce to the local market or to the markets, to the customers outside my place, we have stored all the information in an Excel. After that, we have gone through and we have checked what is the best price. For example, papaya, what is the yield that they have taken, what is the price, average price, what is the peak price, what is the lowest price. Similar to that, each vegetables, we have got the data. The entire data is ready now. Okay, so in my application, in my form, I have the data with me now. Earlier, the farmers, the traditional farmers, they say, I have sold this for this rate, I have sold this for this rate. Only those information that are there with them. Now, I have the information, I have collected the data for 1 year. Then what we did is we tried replicating the produce to sow the seeds. Based on the data that we had, we started planting seeds to get a better pricing, basically. So during some season, we have a better pricing. So if there is any you know, system which can help me in, you know, giving, bus, this is what the price that you have sowed, this is the sown date, seed sown, and this is the yield that you have taken, this is the price, this is the highest price. So ensure that your produce are coming to the market on these days. This may not replicate for the next year. It is completely different, dependent on the market and the climate are prevailing at that time, but it gives a heads up, basically. We need to have a system for that as well. We have the data. So right now I have 2.5 years of data in my database. We tend to see what is good. Now, from month of September till February, if you ask me, if you get into my form, it is completely green. But when in the first year of my cultivation, There were lots of vacant spaces. I missed out that during rainy season, I would have used the open irrigation, that is the open that the rainwater for my harvest. That thought was missed out, and I corrected that immediately the next year, next two cropping cycles. Now if I enter into my, if I go to my farm, it's complete greenery, and every parcel of land has something on it, and it's giving me an yield actually. So where I'm coming is the technology piece here. We have the data. Let's connect the data with the climate, with the temperature, with the pricing. Give a predictive report, predictive analysis that we talk about. An interactive judge bot to tell me, dear farmer, can you grow this, because this has given a maximum yield on this date. Can you grow this with this climate? Can you sow this seed? No, this is what we are looking for. From the technology. So you can add that piece also in the opportunities column. You can think through that as well, and how you can help me out in that. Yeah. Thank you.
Sir, my name is Srividya. I have a doubt, sir.
Yes, Srividya. Go ahead.
Can you explain how the solar dryer works in your land, and how is it useful for your farm, sir?
Okay, solar dryer. In olden days, when I want to dry the paddy or a chilies that has been harvested, they used to dry it in the open land. So in the morning, laborers will come. They will spread the paddy seeds or the chilies, or for that matter, any dal, mung dal or urad dal, any stuff, any stuff that needs drying. They lay down in the open area in the morning, and if it is raining, they immediately need to assemble and they need to pack it. And if it is not raining, at the end of the day, they need to again repack it, and next day morning they need to again put that in the open yard for drying. So the next thing is, the drying is not uniform. In the morning, the temperature is less. In the noon, the temperature is very high, and again the temperature falls down. So the produce gets affected by the fluctuation in temperature, basically. So, but to store a dal or a paddy or the produce, let us say it is a produce, it needs a constant temperature that needs to be maintained there. To ensure that the moisture is not fluctuating. If there is a dip in the moisture, or if it is an increase in the moisture, it may attract pests. If there is an increase in the moisture, it may attract pests. So let's not do that. So and I'm curious about giving value-added products. A banana fruit, if I'm selling it at the local market, I need to dispose it of immediately if I don't have a dryer. If I do that in the open yard, it may have lots of dust, variation in heat, and I may not be able to control the heat, and it needs additional labors. So my dryer, how it solves my problem is, I cut the ripened fruits into pieces, I dry it, and with the help of sensors inside it, I can set the temperature, with whatever the temperature that I want to maintain inside the dryer. It's a polycarbonated sheet. There is a sensor there which senses the temperature inside. It displays, it gives me a display in the external machine, in a display. I set the temperature. The temperature needs to be maintained as 50 or 45 degrees Celsius. I set the temperature. It with the solar panel, I forgot the kilowatt for the solar panel, it maintains the temperature there inside the solar dryer. Even if it is windy or chill outside, when I get into the heater in the dryer, the temperature is definitely much more than what is there outside the farm. During summer season, obviously you cannot stand inside for a minute, basically. And what I do inside is, we dry the entire produce from the farm, like drying chilies, drying dal items, drying the fruits. That is my main crop. Banana is my main crop. So what we are doing is, red banana is rich of medicinal values. It's good in many aspects. Like, it is rich in potassium, it is rich in magnesium, it is rich in fiber content. It is good for immunity. It is good for blood circulation purposes. So it is one of the medicinal fruit that we grow majorly in our area. So I wanted to give that to the kids or to the generation, next generation, in a different format, which they can consume it in a different way. I'll show you the images as well. I hope I might have a couple of images. I'll show that as well. So what we do is we dry that, we cut it, we cut that fruits into smaller pieces. We dry that in the solar dryer. After keeping that, no need for any labor work. After 3 days or 4 days, we can collect it. So 3 days, 4 days, labor work is minimum. It's stopped there. Next is no dust inside the dryer. It is all clean. Temperature can be maintained. Moisture is set to a particular level. Then once the product is dried, once the moisture is removed or otherwise, once the moisture is removed, the shelf life of the product is automatically increases. Say for a banana, it may come, if I keep it as a raw fruit, probably it may come as, it may spoil in 1 or 2 weeks time. But this one is good to eat till 11 months after drying, because once the water is removed, basically all the dried fruits or dried nuts, there is a special price to it is, dried fruits or nuts has 4 times of all the benefits it has in a normal fruit, basically. So that is why the dried fruits are very costlier. See, when I dry 10 kg of fruits, fresh fruits, I'll get 1 to 1.5 kgs of dried fruits. Say if I'm eating 10 gram of dried fruits, which means I'm eating close to 100 gram of banana dried fruit, I'm eating close to 1 kg of banana. That is the difference, basically. So now I market that product as a value-added product. As a value-added product, I bought along with the honey. Honey is sourced from Kurangani Hills, which is close to Theni. We soak that for 30 to 48 days. We sell that in a packed glass container. We don't use plastic bottles. It comes in 50, 100, and 200 gram bottles. We sell it in that way. So it can be consumed as a normal snack. My friends gave an idea. They started using it with the ice creams. They started using it as a, like we used to have a sweetener, right? Like carrot halwa used to have, cake we used to have in ice creams. Similar to that, they started using honey with the honey soaked banana in the ice creams. They started serving. And they say, we're really happy instead of having the honey ice creams alone, they're having healthy snacks. So that is how we change it actually. And even if you come, the climate is not that great, but we have some produce which is kept inside, and we are not worried about the rain that is there in our area, because we have the dryer. It is completely protected, and it serves the purpose of minimal labor. Srividya.
Sir, these bananas, they are a new product now, sir, these dried bananas.
Yes.
For our market, this is a very new product. So
yes.
How did you reach the customers with it? It's a new product. They haven't seen this at all. So how will they be, I'll come forward to buy this if they see it in a market? It is difficult, no, sir. If there's already a normal banana, everyone will come and buy this. But if you're selling something new, everyone will first have that fear inside them. So what is this new product? Do we even need this? These sorts of questions come into the customers' minds. So how did you tackle that? And is this a profitable product, sir, for you? Does this bring a great profit to you?
Good question, Srividya. You have given a deep thought on what you have deep. The question itself is very elaborative, and you have precisely asked the question that we initially asked when we ventured into this. Actually, the intentions were clear, Srividya. The first one is whether I am giving a quality good food to my consumers. That is a tick. Yes. Second, we are introducing a new product. Whether there will be a market for this? When we launch a product, when people launch a product, like when EP or when ITC launch a product, they have a huge market base. Whatever they launch, there is a buyer who can try it out. But when we as a farmer, when we started selling something, there is always, as you rightly told, there is always initial inertia of taking up that product. Why I need to have that? Because there are lots of banana available in the market. Why I need to have this? Okay, that is definitely there. That was definitely there. Even now it is there. And I'll address that question. Okay, I'll let you know how we tackle it. So to address this, we wanted to ensure that whatever we are giving, we wanted to give the nutrients in the tested in the FSSAI lab itself. So we have tested our produce in an FSSAI lab as segregated by the FSSAI organization, which means whatever the benefit that I've told, I've got a proof for that. Actually, we can test for n number of, this is from my banana, from my farm, the whatever the produce that we are producing, it is from the farm only. So we are not getting any second by bananas from any other buyer. So the quality will be the same. So we have got the nutritional benefits details. What is the potassium? What is the magnesium value? What is the protein? What is the fiber content in that? We have got the value. Now, we have analyzed that with the one of the famous fast-selling imported dates. What you are getting from our local product itself, why you want to import basically. That is the initial pitch we have given. Second thing is, initial market, the initial target segment were my customers basically, our customers who believes us. So to get into that customer, we have done lot of activities and we have given the sample. They say somebody liked it, some didn't like it. Some over a period of trying it, they said it's good or wrong. Then with their feedback, we change the soaking time. We have added flavors and all. So we added flavors in the sense, it's not preservative. It is like cinnamon flavored, cardamom flavored, honey soaked bananas. We have added flavors to it to give a different taste to the honey as well as the bananas. So we have gone with the nutritional values. We have taken up the shelf life test. Now comes the marketing. What we have done is, it is a slow moving. We have started a small segment of people where we have started giving it. We've observed the pattern whether they are coming repeatedly to buy. The initial sales was yes, no, it was huge actually. Then after that, there is a dip. Then we have came up with the detailed promotion on what, how, and what is the end product for you. What is that we are producing from the plant growing stage till harvest, till drying, till making the honey soaked banana, what are the benefits, how we are packing it, what is the bottling. Initially, we are giving it in a loose containers. Then we have bottled it. When we have bottled it, it gives a different look to the farmers, to the consumers, basically. They felt it is coming from, we have ensured that it is coming from, our people's mindset is if it is only if it is imported or only if it is from different places, they will say that it is of good quality. But we have in our product, we have mentioned it as Chevvalai Palam in Tamil itself. Because I don't want to leave my authenticity, my place where we belong. So I ensure that this is from Tamil Nadu. And I have not mentioned any flashy locations. My Tirunelveli address, though I have an office in Perambudi, in Chennai as well as in Hosur, I have mentioned in my labeling, it's all mentioned as my Tirunelveli address. So I want to ensure that this is from my route. This is what we are selling. And if you buy this, this is the benefit the farmer is getting. Okay, all this has been given in one or two promotional activities that we have done. Then the next question, this is the campaign that we have done is through WhatsApp, through Facebook pages. We have repeated our organic followers in our pages, so they endorse the product, they started giving recommendations. The next question you asked is whether it is really profitable. As I told you, if I'm selling that product in the market, I need to sell a per kg of product to the local market at 10 rupees to 15 rupees, or for max 20 rupees. Okay. But if I'm selling it to the organic, I do have customers from Chennai, Bangalore, Hosur, all across Tamil Nadu, apart from Bangalore. Okay. I ship produce to them. I ship it at a very fixed price, that is 90 rupees for them plus the shipping charges, or to the retailers who have organic shops. I sell it at some rate, at a much lesser rate, 70 rupees per kg. That is the rate. This is for your calculation, since you asked for the economics involved. So I wanted to have at least 70 rupees, or if I'm getting more than 10 rupees of what the local market is, till max, no, the maximum price at the local market can be 30 rupees or 35 rupees. That is the maximum price that we'll get even in any of the driest period. So if I'm getting at least 10 rupees or 15 rupees more than that, I'm making a value addition for that, and I'm not in a compulsion to sell my product immediately to the local market at whatever the price it is coming. So I have a holding period. Yes, I have a holding period. If the returns are more than 8% to 12%, yes, the returns are more than 12%, yes. If the returns are constant, yes, the returns are constant. Whether the product is reselling, whether the takers who have bought has repeatedly buying it, yes. Whether the product size is growing, the customer size is growing, yes, very slowly. I'll tag that word, it is growing very slowly. As even now, there is a mentality that bananas are already available in the market. Why need to buy this dried one? We are promoting for the kids basically as an alternate snack, because my kids love that. My kids and my friends' families love that to give that as an alternative snack. Instead of having a munching the five star or a Milky Bar or munches, no, they started giving this and they see a remarkable changes in their behaviors. They'll not go to any shops and cry for the chalky section. They know we have a very good snack at home. They are giving that to them. So to answer your question, I hope I have answered. If there is anything I missed out, please let me know. It is profitable. It is really challenging. Still, we are working on how to address that. Yes, we are working on it. And there is a slight increase in the purchase. And whether the customers are repetitive, yes, the customers are repetitive. Why I need to go for the dried vegetables, dried fruits, dried nuts? Because dried fruits has at least 4 times of water the nutrients that it has in a normal fruit. Hope I have answered your question, Sridhar.
Yes, sir. You answered my question very well, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Sir, can you hear me?
Yes.
I just want to ask this. You have been investing like almost minimum it would be around 20 lakhs for a period of 5 years, I guess. How did you hold the debt and how did you manage those cash flow and those kind of problems?
May I know your name, please?
Rajesh.
Rajesh. Hi, Rajesh. Good morning. See, hi, sir. It is a not three people partnership firm. Okay, first is that we know that it may not give the payback as we expect. Actually, the payback period that we are talking about, it will be in years, not even in 5 years, 7 years time. Okay, that I consider as an investment. Like investing in the land is an investment basically. I'm not looking for any returns. If I sell the land, yes, it is triple the rate that what I bought. Okay, the market value is tripled, the valuation is tripled since I have bought for the normal land. But if you consider our land, definitely it is worth 4 to 5 times of the market price and people are ready to buy it. That is one thing. So valuation has gone up. That is one thing. Second thing is we are focusing on the working capital. Initially we have invested our time and money in producing our in the cultivation, initial stages of cultivation. Now it's been close to 1 year and 4 months. We are not investing anything, any additional money in the farm. It is self-running, self-sustaining. The investment we have made, we have not taken it back, but the valuation has gone up. Okay. See, the project size, for example, I'm quoting, it is 1 crore we have invested. The valuation for that property alone might be 4-5 crores. It has gone to 4 to 5 crores. That is what I'm trying to tell. Whether we are investing anything newly, no, we are not doing anything. The farm is sustaining on its own. What I mean here is whatever the produce that is being produced in the farm, the price or the sale produce, the sale value from the farm is used to operate the farm, to address the fertigation needs, to address the labor needs, to address the plowing or machinery needs. It's all been addressed. And yes, last 16 months, that is 1 year and 4 months, we are not investing any new money. The next one is whatever the crop that we have cultivated, are we at loss? Are we making money? Yes, we are making money. How much? It varies between 20 to 60%. If I invest for example, 10,000 for a period of 3 months in watermelon, in cucumber, in bitter gourd or in red gourd, $15,000 to $30,000 to $40,000. That is the, if I sell it organically to my organic consumers, the products are shipped from my location. I forgot to mention that as well. So we ship all produce from my farm to people across the Tamil Nadu and Bangalore. Today, Wednesday, Monday and Wednesday are the shipping days wherein which we ship our produce from our farm to people, to our customers directly. Today, we have say Nendran bananas and papayas are going out of my farm today. If we sell all those produce to our direct customers or to our organic retailers, the profit is more. If we sell to the local retailers, so in that time the profit might be less, but we are at profit. We are not making any loss. We have learned many lessons in initial 6 months. We have corrected all those learnings, and the working capital is met. Whatever the produce that we are making, it is sold at a profitable rate. If the, whether have I taken the investment, there is no plan to take the investment back. It is all there. The valuations have gone up. We need to see the valuations over a period. Okay.
Oh, okay, sir.
Yeah, Rajesh, tell me, do you want more from me, or anything is missed out from me? Let me know.
Yeah, no, you answered this question perfectly, but I have some other questions also.
Go ahead.
Like you have collected those data, right? Can we use this data for artificial intelligence, and so that we can predict those patterns? And we can if we make it around 90, more than 90% accuracy, so that we can ensure that we make profits in a more sustainable manner.
Definitely, Rajesh, I'm happy to share that information. So you most of the fertigation technologies or the financial data that you, if you're looking for, I'm happy to supply that. That is the essence I'm talking about, Rajesh. So I'm happy to supply that. If you come up with using AI, using machine learning, if you come up with something to give me the recommendations, it's all welcome. I'm happy to share that. Whatever the information that I have, I'm happy to share that. That is what I'm looking for from the young minds, Rajesh.
Yeah, happy to see that, sir.
Thank you. So you can connect with Kartika, madam. She can help you in getting the data from me.
Yeah, okay, sir.
Okay.
Sir, you said this farm is in Tirunelveli, no, sir?
Yes.
So there are many windmills. Tirunelveli, basically, there are many windmills are there. So are you using those windmills in conjunction with solar energy to provide electricity for your farm, sir?
Windmill. It is even in close to our farm, there are many windmills that are available, but to get the electricity, we need to install one, and after we need to again hand over all the units to the grid, and from there we need to again get back. It is not direct, actually. So we don't have any tie-up with any of the windmill owners, actually. So it is running on its own. Probably sooner than later we might, if I have something on its own, I need to have it separately, not from my farm directly. So it is all completely packed for the next 4 or 5 years, what needs to be there in which place, all has been planned, and we are working towards that plan. And there were some tweaks that we have made, and the windmill is not in our scope, Shivya. It is not in our scope whether to install or not. And we are not using any, we are not having any tie with the windmill loan accessory.
Sir, what about solar panels, sir? Because our government, they said that they are giving some concession for whomever. Installing solar panels for their own purposes. So are you venturing into that, sir?
Yeah, solar pump, we have moved to the solar pump. For that, solar panels are installed, actually. Since I have got that subsidy, it comes with the subsidy. I have utilized the subsidy. See, okay, the government has helped me a lot. The Agri Department and the Solar Agri Engineering Division has helped me a lot in getting solar dryer. It comes with the subsidy. solar pumps, it comes with the subsidy. Power tillage, it comes with the subsidy. Drip irrigation, it comes with the subsidy. Sprinklers, it comes with the subsidy. The water tank that I built, it comes with the subsidy. Now they are giving me a subsidy for making an integrated farming. The beehives that I've got, bee boxes that I've got, it comes with the subsidy. They are giving me subsidy now to buy a cow, a goat, and a hen, and also to have a vermicompost bed, permanent vermicompost bed for my farm. It all comes with the subsidy basically. And since I've got the earlier subsidy sometime back, I'm not eligible to get the newer model that they have come up with. Whatever the subsidy they've got was much, much cheaper. It is 90% contribution from the farm, from the government, and 10% from the farmer. Now it is 70-30 from the farmer. So since I've utilized most of the subsidy for the solar, we are not not eligible for CADO Organics as such, is not eligible to get that new funding for our production of solar energies. But once that is ready, definitely we will go there actually to get the the solar panels installed in our farm.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Sir, you said about the agriculture industry, right? Agriculture is definitely a industry. I honestly have not got my hands dirty with farming. But what I heard is that small scale and medium scale farming aren't economically viable. But your vision states that you are gonna make it more profitable, sustainable. So how are you gonna make it, sir? So that's what my question is.
Oh, it's a very deep thought question. I didn't get your name. It's Rajesh again or someone else?
Yeah, I'm Rajesh.
Okay, Rajesh. Okay, it's a very, very, very good question actually. The marginal farmers contributes more than 80% of the Indian farming population actually. And if I wanted to say, there was a recommendation given by Manmohan Singh sometime back. Okay. People who has got less than 1 acre of land, they need to see alternate income from the farm. Okay, otherwise they cannot sustain economically, is the recommendation that he has given. Okay, what is the other income? Can I do any value addition from the produce that I'm getting? Instead of, I'll give a classic example, which we are doing it right now. Mapulai Chamba is a bride, also called as bridegroom rice. It's very famous to help improve the immunity. So it is widely consumed across Tamil Nadu. Okay, but you cannot consume it directly. Okay, you need to have patience, or no, you may not like it to have actually. It's not like a normal white rice. It is a red rice. Have a hard skin on it. If I go with the traditional hand pounding way of removing the skins, so. What we are coming up with is, I have asked the farmer's wife to support him in making a laddu with the Mapulai Chamba variety of rice and millets. For example, kambu, when I say pearl millet, people say it is used for porridge making. It's cool, solvangala. It is for making porridge, right? Apart from kambu porridge, what all we can do? That is what we started exploring. Then we started giving a different flavor called as laddu. It is powdered, it gives mixed with ghee. Ghee again, it is taken from the organically cow grazed in organically grown farm. Cashews again from the organic farmer, and this main varieties that whether it is Mapulai Chamba, Karpu Kavuni, or millets, pearl millets in case we are using kambu, foxtail millet, and pearl millet, that is Tinai or kambu. We are using all this to come up with kambu laddu, Mapulai Chamba laddu. It is an additional income. First, it is an additional income for them. It's a value added product. They are giving to me. I have asked them to come up with this. They started giving the laddus to me. We have the snacks that we eat in our home is like this: fruits grown organically, honey-soaked banana made organically, snacks grown organically and produced organically from the farmers actually. So we have asked them to make it for us. We are selling it for them. We give repetitive orders. Thereby they are making value-added product, additional income from there. And so this is one piece I'm talking about. Okay, this is one piece I'm talking about. Value addition is one thing that people need to look, and we are educating them to come up with additional income basically. And even with that, even with the additional income after selling their produce, because the broken rice, we use the broken rice for making the laddus and all, because broken rice sells at half of the price basically. So we use that to give a price matching the normal price of the rice actually. So whatever they have, they know farming. We have given some knowledge on making the value added products and how to make with mask, with the hand gloves, with the cap on the head, and all this. They started doing this from their home, and they feel now they are selling it at one price to me, and they are directly selling it also, which gives a better yield for them. So they are generating an additional income. The next question, whether that additional income is enough for their economic stability, that needs to be still addressed, Rajesh. But they are far better placed than their counterparts who are doing that. That is the one thing that I can vouch for them. And we are trying to sell them directly also. Also, people they are obsessed with brands. No, we are obsessed with brands. I use only, people say, I use only iPhones. I use, what is this? I use only OnePlus. Sorry, guys, I don't use this. But there are people who use that. Similar to that, there are brand obsessed people who love Cardo. Okay. Who, anything with Cardo sticker, they are ready to buy because they know that it is from me. And I am very, very passionate about my farming. And they love to buy that sticker. So people who want that, I'm giving it to them. People who buy it, no, it's okay. If you are recommending, then I'm fine. We are selling it to, we are asking them to ship directly also. So this is the support that we are doing. And they are far better and much better placed than their counterparts. And one important thing we do is we ask them to cultivate the natural varieties of rices. If 1 acre of land, he holds 1 acre of land. Instead of some XYZ varieties, I recommend them to harvest 10 different rices. I have focusing on 9 varieties of rices currently. We might add one more and we'll end up with 10 varieties of rice, which is all native variety rice. The aim is to ensure that variety is widely used by people and it is the seeds are propagated to the farmers. From 10 farmers, we have gradually gone to 22 farmers right now. And the target is by the end of next year, that is 2022, we will end up with at least 50 farmers who are cultivating those native variety seeds for our consumption, which means when people cultivates more, the price is affordable. Many people can buy. That is where, when many people buy, the mission to give good food for 1% of Indian population becomes a reality after some point of time. So that is where we are working on it.
Yes, sir. Definitely the value addition is going to benefit them, but I'm just concerned about the infrastructure they lack in farming, sir. Like they need a farm pond for irrigation and things like that. We need a motor set, we need place for that, sir. But if they farm at 1 acre, it becomes very economically not feasible, sir. So how we address those challenges, and can you give me some insights on it, sir?
With half acre land, if he wanted to put a bore well, definitely it is not going to be profitable, or it is not going to be sustaining for him. And currently, I'll come across a place. When I was a regional credit manager, Ramanathapuram taluk, Ramanathapuram district comes under my region. So the 6 months they harvest, actually it is all rain irrigation, okay, rain fed irrigation, no proper bore wells and all, nothing. It is all rain fed.
Okay.
Only those 6 months they do rain farming. Remaining 6 months they do value added products like coal. No, coal, they make the charcoals basically for ironing and all, for giving it to the industry boilers, for boilers and all, they make the coals basically. It is one of the major side income for them. They do that actually. In some belts of Tiruvannamalai, they 3 months crop, if you put, there are people who harvest even now three seasons actually. With the facility that they have, they share it actually. Instead of 9 acres, 10 acres, they say, I'll do 2 acres of harvest this year. There is a mutual agreement and arrangement between the farmer. They are doing that using the whatever the well that is available, common well that is available. They are using that remaining period. For them, no, we are giving the suggestions of making a value-added product from the produce that you have had. If you ask me, can a farmer with half acre or 1 acre land, can he go for a bore well? If you ask me, the straight away question, the answer to that question is no. Don't do that. Use rain-fed irrigation or the common channel of irrigation that is available there. A bore well is sustainable only if you have minimum of 3 to 4 acres. Otherwise, no. Or in a lighter note, your land should be in a place where, like in Huzur or Bangalore, even if you have 1.5 acre of land, you can cultivate very decent varieties of plants like cabbage, cauliflower, carrots, capsicum. This gives a better return. Even in 1 acre, you can get a very huge profit in that. So if you hold your land in those areas, you can go and do all these irrigation methods of digging a borewell or connecting having an EB connection or not. But for other areas which is dry, in the area that I visited, Trivannamalai, Pudukkottai, Madurai, Tirunelveli, if you ask me, I would recommend not to do that. Actually, don't do that. Use common irrigation. Otherwise, no. In 10 acres, in the land that I have 3 boreholes. It is still sufficient to irrigate my entire land. But I am very cautious in looking at only during the month of September to February. I harvest the entire land. I use the entire land. Otherwise, it is only 60 to 70% of the land that I use. Though the water facility is there, I am trying to recharge my boreholes through digging small ponds, and I'm recharging my boreholes. Once I'm satisfied, I'm happy with the recharging methods and technique that I've done, I might use the entire land parcel for my harvest, for my cultivation, but not now.
Yeah, okay, sir.
Yeah.
Students, any other question? Thank you, sir. Thank you for your wonderful presentation and way of your answering the questions. Everything very nice, sir. Thank you, sir.
Now, thank you all for the opportunities given. Thank you, Kartika, for the coordination. Wonderful coordination. You have been following up with me for last 1 week. Whether I'm okay, yes, with this, whether my timing is okay, whether I have prepared, even yesterday I had a call from you, sir. Whether all this has been fine. Whether we are on track, hope we have. There is no change in the schedule. It's been a wonderful follow up from you, Kartika. Thank you so much. And thank you, HOD, sir, for the wonderful introduction that you have given. And thank you, my dear student friends. It's been a real pleasure to interact with you all. As I told you, you young minds have lots to do, and we are looking at you to support.
I see, to propose the vote of thanks.
Thank you. Good morning, and all present here. It gives me an immense pleasure to deliver the vote of thanks for this event to all dignitaries assembled here. I take this golden opportunity to thank our respected chief guest, Mr. Arun Kumar Gandhi, Manager, Accenture Solutions India Private Limited, founding farmer, Cardo Organics, who honored this function with his inspirational thoughts. I extend my gratitude to our distinguished management, beloved Principal Sir, Dean Research Sir, for their constant guidance and motivation for organizing such events. My sincere thanks to our respected head of the department for his kind support. I would like to thank all the faculty members and the students for their active participation. With these warm words, we move to the end of this webinar. Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you.